Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honor and pleasure for me, and also that the minister is still here. I know that you have some tight time schedule, as we all have, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about science and innovation in aerospace. I will not go into detail of different science activities, but first of all, I would like to ask a question. So, what are we doing? Usually, there are a lot of questions, and we are used to all of these questions when we are having any type of science or technology question raised. And I think the most important question of this is the why question. Usually, we are accustomed that we do something, and that if somebody is asking, like, why are you doing that, we are explaining it. I think we have to turn it around. We have to start with the why question. The why question is the most important, and then we can go on with all the other questions. And this leads me to the basis of what we are doing. If you look here, the basis is the why question should be the challenge. The challenge, why we are doing something. And there, we can look into the past. You know these two guys. When I heard that there are many Russians over here, you know very well the right-hand side person, and the Western world knows the left one. And John F. Kennedy is well known to launch the idea to fly to the moon. What was his intention? Was it science? Was it pioneering? Look to the original text. He said, I believe this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal. You don't have to read even more. You see what his intention was. I believe this nation should commit itself. He did not say, we should fly to the moon because it's nice to science, etc. So his why was a very clear why. It was clear. It was for the nation's pride. And this was during the Cold War, the race in space between the Western and the Eastern world. And of course, it started really with the first astronaut and the first cosmonaut, with Yuri Gagarin on the Russian side, and less than 4 weeks later with Alan Shepard, who did not go into orbit but had a parabolic flight. So this was really a very strong competition. And the cynical advantage of the Cold War was funding was available. I mean, that was all the time. We could use dollars, we could use all the different rubles and whatever you ask for. What is today? What of these whys is your why? Is it national institutional pride? Is it really gone? Are we not still working with national pride, for instance, in ESA, when we are fighting between the different nations about the geo-return? But what about the other aspects? Global responsibility, it sounds so nice. Do we really catch up? Human heritage is also in a nice wording, or national security, individual benefits, individual national global prosperity. I think we have to a little bit to formalize this procedure, and for us, for DLR, it's very clear. It's the global challenges. Which we have to put into the center. And all the other aspects, national pride, whatever you call it, should be in a lower priority. There's one very special global challenge, which is in our world of calculating everything in euros and dollars, which is forgotten sometimes. This is curiosity. Curiosity is the strongest driver of humans. We should not neglect that one. And therefore, DLR decided to use as its motto, knowledge for tomorrow. DLR is, as we heard right now, it's a research center for aeronautics, space, energy, transport, and security. And at the same time, we are the German space agency handling the money of the federal government to give it to industry, to scientists, and also to the European Space Agency. In our research part, we are trying to couple these aspects of aeronautics, space, energy, transport, and security every day. So it's our goal, for instance, if we are creating a new high-speed train, we better use the aerodynamics of a plane. And therefore, we formulated four main items which we are covering. The first two are invention and innovation. Invention meaning really basic research, the first idea in some direction, and innovation meaning that we have a product which goes into the market. Interaction means that we are trying internally and externally to interact between different areas and different nationalities, different industries, etc. And internationality, I think this is a very simple statement. So if we look to that, and then we should also look into the different areas of aeronautics and space. Here, for space, we need always a seamless chain of space activities, starting with the launcher and then some orbiting activities. Maybe we fly to another planet or any other aspect in the space, and then finally return and landing, bringing some goods or even astronauts back to Earth. And very similar to the area of transport. And here you see in the picture, in the center of that picture, you see a very strange symbol. This should mean intermodal access to the airport, security at the airport, then of course flying of the planes, coming back, and of course because I'm from Cologne, finally Carnival and the beer of Cologne is important. But if you look into the center, this should mean that we should also look to the environmental aspects of all the different activities. And then it comes, if you have all of these stories, it comes again to the question between invention and innovation, or as I call it, the seamless chain of innovation. There is direct input and there is indirect results. Direct meaning we have a space idea, and at the end we have a space mission, for instance an astronaut on the moon. So we need many technologies to realize that. Indirect means that we are using the results from one research field to a totally different area. I call it the Teflon pan effect, knowing that the Teflon pan does not come from space, but I think the effect is very clear. So if you now look into this picture, you see a picture from the left-hand side to the right-hand side, from basic research to the market, that meaning from invention to innovation, or you can also draw it with the technology readiness level with the different areas. And it's very important that we focus on the work that we are doing this as a seamless chain from the left to the right. As you start this line, we always sort of give a place for disruptive ideas at the very beginning. And this is also a request to the politicians, that we should not only look to the return of investment in the very next day, we should give people, especially also young people, I know that there are many students over here, the ability and the opportunity to define really very totally new ideas. And then you see, you will become a mammoth hunter like your dad. That's the future, is the wrong answer to that. So there are always some inventions which can pave the way. If you look now to aeronautics and space, then the simple solution would be, okay, we start here with some basic research and go up to the market or in space also. That would be the simple solution. For DLR, we are doing that, for instance, with this very big equipment, which is an autoclave for the production of carbon fiber reinforced structures. But DLR is doing more. DLR is not only aeronautics, space, but also energy transport and security. And we always, as I mentioned earlier, we're trying to combine these. So we are using results from aeronautics to transport, or from energy to space. So the interaction is very important. And for the future, I think it's even more important to have also a combination with totally different fields. I just mentioned here water, agriculture, entertainment, medicine, you can name it. So it's very important that we don't stay within our line, but that we give the chance also to move to other directions and other fields. Now I will give you some examples. We heard about flight radar, as you mentioned. Did you ever see airplanes over the Atlantic? Yes, you saw. Did you know that you cannot know it, because there is no information where the plane is if it's above the Atlantic? There is no, only the pilot knows where he is, but there is no direct information about that. But with Proba V, an ESA satellite, which with a German ADS-B receiver, we now can really determine where a plane is. Here you see some first results. All of these planes were defined and identified. Another one is, we have always some catastrophes in the world, and we should be ready to use all our knowledge to help people after an earthquake, after tsunami, after a forest fire or whatever. And there we created, together with international partners, the International Charter of Space and Major Disasters. If I say we, I should say ESA and CNES started it, and then some other, as for instance DLR joined. But also using now the results of space for day-to-day applications, for instance in this case for a train. You know, if you have a train on a single track in total opposite direction, there is the problem, the danger of a collision. And by using satellite navigation, we can inform the train where he is, in which direction he drives, and which speed. And then if both trains are communicating, then the accuracy must be single on the single track, the accuracy, then we can prevent any collision in the future. Another one is, most of you know about the Curiosity on Mars. If you look to that Curiosity, you will find out that there is no solar panel on it. So where does the energy come from? It's just an example. We are using the same method also for Cassini-Huygens, for instance. It's what we call an isotopic battery. Isotopic battery is a nice word for plutonium. So there is some plutonium on board, and the heat of the plutonium is used by a thermoelectric generator to produce electricity. Now we are transferring this technology into the day-to-day car, into a normal car without the plutonium. So we are using the heat of the exhaust pipe, and you see here, it's a Bavarian product. You see the heat of the exhaust pipe is used to produce electricity, and by that we can reduce the emission and the fuel consumption of the car. But also for energy in general, space is a helpful tool. Here you see a picture where the solar radiation on the ground is shown in different colors. Green meaning here is a lot of solar radiation on the ground, including all the clouds and all these aspects. And now you know where you can gain solar power. Now the question is, where do you need the power? And then you can take again a satellite and using a night view. And the night view is here, you see the lighting of the different areas during night. And you see that these two pictures do not fit to each other. So you need the energy where you don't have it, and the other way around. If you look to Northern Africa, and Northern Africa here, if you look to Munich, also we have a sun in Munich, not as much as the others. And you see we need a lot of energy over here. So this then came to the project energy from the desert. I will show you a final small video. This lady is paralyzed from the neck downwards. And she has a sensor in her head, and this is a DLR computer, and she is moving that DLR computer, DLR robot, by using just her brain. So without any connection, it's directly brain steered, and you see for the first time in her life, she could move and drink something by herself. I think this shows what we can do with space, with aeronautics, and we should not just stay within what we are doing right now. We should look to other fields, and therefore I thank you for your attention.